was a lot of excitement. It's been a long time for me. I told them I'm sick of being a bridesmaid, and now they keep saying you're a bride. I said, no, I'm not there yet. I'm just getting closer to the altar.
Confidence that the 1990 season would bring them more of the same. Tony La Russa's task would be to keep the A's from growing complacent, from resting on past laurels. The Bash Brothers certainly didn't, as Jose Canseco hit 37 home runs in 1990. Mark McGwire would become the first man in history to hit 30 or more homers in his first four full major league seasons. Also getting high marks, Ricky Henderson, the ultimate catalyst. Ricky hit a career-high 325 in 1990 and passed Ty Cobb to become the American League's stolen base leader.
Ricky's going! Pitches high! He stole it! The American League record for Ricky Henderson!
From Bob Welch, the A's also got a career year, with a major league leading 27 wins. Dave Stewart won 20 for the fourth year in a row, and as a bonus, got his first career no-hitter. Even when things went sour for the A's, like the loss of Dave Henderson, the team responded by acquiring veterans Harold Baines and Willie McGee. Oakland won its division, then left Boston in its wake in the championship series, sweeping the Sox in four straight. The A's did not grow complacent. What they did was win their third consecutive pennant, something just 21 teams have managed to do in the history of baseball. The 1990 Oakland A's primed for the World Series like never before. In Cincinnati, Reds owner Marge Schott hired Lou Piniella to turn a team of promise unfulfilled into one that would make a little noise in the National League West. The optimism was contagious.
If we start out and win our first 30, 35 games in a row, we're going to be in first place.
I agree.
The thing is, they were serious, winning their first 9 games in 23 of their first 30. The Reds as a team were as nasty as their bullpen, which was led by Rob Dibble's 1.74 run average, and the stopper, Randy Myers, who had 31 nasty saves in 66 games. It was obvious these Reds were a throwback to the old days. They were feisty and fired up and wouldn't take no for an answer. They were in first place from day one, and during a rain delay in late September, they got what they deserved. Nothing could dampen this moment for the Reds. They had won the West in style. It was on to the playoffs against the Pittsburgh Pirates, and it was in game two that Paul O'Neill got them going, driving in both runs in a 2-1 victory that evened the series at one game apiece. O'Neill also cut down the potential tying run in the sixth.
There's the catch, and the runner moves on to third base, and he's out!
The venue shifted to Pittsburgh for game three, and the power shifted to the Mighty Mites of Cincinnati, led by Mariano Duncan, who had a homer and four RBIs in the Reds' 6-3 triumph. In game four, it was Chris Sabo who carried the offense. With a two-run home run and three RBIs, he led the Reds to a 5-3 win as the Pirates took a walk on the losing side. Defense, once again, made news for the Reds, with the headliner this time, Eric Davis.
O'Neill is going to go for third with one out. He is!
Pirates won Game 5, but in Game 6, Luis Quiñones got a clutch pinch hit in the seventh inning to give the Reds a 2-1 lead. All that remained was still another defensive gem, this one by Glenn Braggs, and some nasty boy relief from Randy Myers, and the Cincinnati Reds were the National League champions. The first time they could make that claim since 1976. They'd be underdogs in the series, but they were cocky and confident with nothing to lose.
The last time the A's and the Reds hooked up in a World Series was 1972. It was a seven-game affair, with six games were decided by one run before the A's emerged triumphant. Now, 18 years later, once again, it's the A's and the Reds. And we asked our CBS Sports baseball analyst, Jim Cott and Tim McCarver, to size up these two league champions.
Well, the Oakland Athletics showed the baseball world they can win games without hitting home runs. In fact, they're the first team in 71 years to win a postseason series without hitting one. They really win games with defense and great pitching, and sometimes we tend to overlook their starting pitching. Well, we've got Bob Welch, the number two starter for the Oakland Athletics. He won 27 games during the regular season. He'll be the American League Cy Young Award winner, yet he's starting game two. Dave Stewart is the ace of this staff. Great postseason record. And between them, Stewart and Welch have won more games than any two pitchers in the same team than Sandy Koufax and Don Drysdale back in the late 60s. Think about this. If this series goes seven games, the Cincinnati Reds will have to face Stewart or Welch in five of those games.
And I think it bodes well also for the Athletics that all of their starting pitchers are right-handed. That's not the case with the Cincinnati Reds. Jose Rijo starting tonight is right-handed, but Danny Jackson starting tomorrow night and Tom Browning starting on Friday night are left-handed, and the Oakland Athletics hit about 40 points higher against left-handed pitching than they do right-handers. I think if the Cincinnati Reds are going to win, they're going to have to do it with speed and defense. They have six of their eight guys that they're starting tonight. Yes, Hal Morris and Paul O'Neill, they can run well too. They're going to be able to run and open things up. I think that's what Lou Piniella's going to have to do, open it wide open. And as far as their defense is concerned, I think they're going to have to play the same type of defense that they played against Pittsburgh. Tight outfield defense. You saw what Glenn Braggs did, leaping above the fence to make the catch in game six. And the four assists, two by O'Neill, and the brilliant play by Eric Davis in Pittsburgh.
Well, and I think the Athletics don't have team speed to match up with the Cincinnati Reds, but they've got some great individual speed. Ricky Henderson, best base dealer in baseball. You got Willie McGee and Jose Canseco. And on defense, the A's have a better defensive infield than outfield. Great infield defense. That could suffer in the series because of the injury to Walt Weiss. Mike Gallego, normally a second baseman, will move over to shortstop. Veteran Willie Randolph will go to second base. They could lose a step in range with that combination on AstroTurf. That might be a factor.
I love how Tony La Russa weaves in very methodically his left-hander Rick Honeycutt to probably face Paul O'Neill and Hal Morris in late-inning situations. And Gene Nelson with a double play ball. And Dennis Eckersley probably and arguably the best relief pitcher in the last two decades.
And then if you're the Reds, you got the nasty boys. They don't care if they're left-handed or right-handed. They've struck out more hitters than any other bullpen in baseball history. Really, the only difference I can see with these two bullpens, late in the game, one of the nasty boys could walk Ricky Henderson, and that could be a factor. I don't see Dennis Eckersley walking anybody.
I foresee tonight a six-inning game. Whoever's ahead after six innings is going to win the ballgame.
With a lot of strategy early in the game by both managers to try to score a run.
Some not-so-random thoughts from the field before game one.
Well, a newspaper here this morning summed up the local feeling. The underdog Reds versus the awesome A's, and why not? After all, Oakland is riding a remarkable streak of 10 straight postseason games, including sweeps of last year's World Series against the Giants and last week's American League Championship Series against the Red Sox. Cincinnati Reds have their share of accomplishments to be proud of as well. This year, they became the first team in the National League to lead the regular season standings from wire to wire. And, of course, they overcame a tough Pittsburgh squad in a six-game NLCS. So as we get right to work at starting pitching, where we start, and where this series may well be decided. Oakland opens with Dave Stewart, Jose Rijo for the Reds. Stewart has been baseball's best pitcher for the past four seasons, and he's now won six, count them, six straight postseason games, one shy of Bob Gibson's record. Jose Rijo will open for the Reds. He won game four of the NLCS, and down the stretch, he's been the most consistent pitcher for Cincinnati. Take a look at Jose arriving at the ballpark. He got some last-minute encouragement from his father-in-law, Hall of Famer Juan Marichal, and a kiss from his wife, the former Rosie Marichal. Juan Marichal, ironically, is on the A's payroll as their chief Latin American scout. But both pitchers will be facing cleanup hitters who continue to play hurt. Jose Canseco of the A's hurt the middle finger of his right hand in a freak accident at home in the kitchen. He's been getting daily treatment, and I asked him about his health less than an hour ago.
Arm is definitely gripping the bat and also throwing. This is the power thing when you throw a ball, is where you control it. So it's kind of weak right now, it's rolling, but I'll just have to do the best I can.
As for Eric Davis of the Reds, he has played all season with an injured right knee. September 27th, he's making a spectacular catch, and he could not control his momentum, and his left shoulder slams into a thinly padded wall. And because of the injury, he told us tonight that it's going to affect the way he hits in this series.
Yeah, that's the only thing you can do right now. If I was feeling good, then I would probably sooner a little bit more bat speed or look for a particular pitch and try to see that ballpark. But under the circumstances, I'm just looking to put the bat on the ball and make good contact.
And the other big injury story, A's starting shortstop Walt Weiss, he sprained his knee ligaments in game two of the ALCS. He's out for the series.
The 1990 World Series between the Oakland A's and the Cincinnati Reds opened in Cincinnati, Ohio, where the focus was on the defending world champions with their mighty bats and their big-name stars. The only ones paying attention to the Reds were the A's themselves, especially their studious manager, who was already looking for whatever edge he could find. It was time to make new friendships and rekindle old ones. And it was time for one starting pitcher to offer some advice to the other. But Jose Rio already had all the advice he'd need, thanks to former pitcher Juan Marichal, who also happens to be Rio's father-in-law. Marichal forged a Hall of Fame career with the Giants with six 20-win seasons in the 60s, and that extra high kick that made him a menacing figure on the mound. These days, Juan is a scout for Oakland, and indirectly, a matchmaker.
My father was working for the Oakland A's, well, he still is, and my mother and I, we went to pick him up where he worked at this baseball field, and I met Rio, but it was so funny because I didn't even meet him. They didn't even introduce us to each other, but we saw each other. And then that's the way. And then that night I saw him at the stadium. He's like, hi, gorgeous. And that's the way, you know, that we met.
2 years later, they were married. And while Juan got a grandchild out of the deal, Jose ended up with a pretty good pitching coach.
My father, he was a great pitcher, and he gives them a lot of advice, especially on concentration. And Rio, he sticks, you know, he goes by his words, and he's done great.
Sometimes he loses the concentration, like that home run against Freeman. I think that was lack of concentration. But
I agree.
They really have something really special going, because it's, you know, it's more than just like a father-in-law. He's like a father to him. Like the father that Rio never had, my dad is like his father.
But now Juan faces a dilemma. His son-in-law is scheduled to be the starting pitcher in game one of the World Series against the team that gives Juan his paycheck. So for whom does he root?
I want him to do a good job, but I want Oakland to win.
Somewhere deep inside, I know he has to be pulling, or at least wishing, that Rio does his job. You know, not that he's gonna just root for the A's, but my father does have to be pulling for Rio to do his job and come out looking, you know, good.
Game time, and the family parts along company lines. We already know for whom Rosie is rooting. Meantime, up in the booth, next door to the CBS voices of Jack Buck and Tim McCarver, Juan prepares for his Spanish language broadcast.
Hola,
over, but look what lies ahead. You know, the Reds and their fans have been waiting for these moments since 1976. It's not a real long time ago, but when you're talking baseball, it's a lifetime. And so you can understand why the good folks here in Cincinnati have been celebrating nonstop, and why just this afternoon over 7,000 of them held a pep rally in downtown Fountain Square. You know what color they've been painting this town. But there's a group of Northern Californians who have made it a habit to spoil the party. And soon we'll start finding out whether this October is a time for destiny or dynasty. And so on this pleasant 68-degree autumn evening in the Queen City, it's game one of the World Series. The Oakland Athletics and the Cincinnati Reds on CBS Sports. Let's meet the principals. And right now, to make the introductions, let's go to public address announcer John Browdy.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to Riverfront Stadium for Game 1 of the 1990 World Series between the Oakland Athletics and the Cincinnati Reds. Now, presenting the American League champion, Oakland Athletics. Introducing Athletics manager Tony La Russa. Here is the Athletics starting lineup. Leading off, playing left field, number 24, Ricky Henderson. Batting second and playing center field, number 51, Willie McGahee. Hitting third and playing right field, number 33, Jose Canseco. Hitting fourth and playing first base, number 25, Mark McGwire. Batting fifth and playing third base, number 4, Tony Lansford. Batting sixth and catching, number 36, Jerry Steinbach. Hitting seventh and playing second base, number 30, Willie Randall. Batting eighth and playing shortstop, number 9, Mike Gallego. And batting ninth and pitching for the Athletics, in the bullpen, number 34, Dave Stewart. And the rest of the Oakland Athletics. Now presenting the National League champion, Cincinnati Reds. Introducing Reds manager, Lou Piniella. Here is the Reds starting lineup. Leading off and playing shortstop, number 11, Barry Larkin. Batting second and playing center field, number 22, Billy Hatcher. Hitting third and playing right field, number 21, Paul O'Neill. Hitting fourth and playing left field, number 44, Eric Davis. Batting fifth and playing first base, number 23, Al Morris. Batting sixth and playing third base, number 17, Chris Sabo. Hitting seventh and catching, number 9, Joe Oliver. Batting eighth and playing second base, number 7, Mariano Duncan. And batting ninth and pitching for the Reds in the bullpen, number 27, Jose Rijo. Ladies and gentlemen, we ask you to please rise, face the American flag in center field, and join United States Air Force Captain Alan Boykin in the singing of our national anthem.
Out of the World Series and a head-on collision with the American League champion Oakland A's, who swept the Giants in the 1989 World Series and obliterated the Boston Red Sox, taking four straight in the 1990 ALCS. The Athletics proclaimed themselves a dynasty, and the media was quick to agree. Comparisons to the all-time great teams flowed easily. The Bash Brothers, Jose Canseco and Mark McGwire, 20-game winners Dave Stewart and Bob Welch, and bullpen closer Dennis Eckersley created an imposing image. The Reds were labeled a 3-1 underdog, and many media pundits doubted the Reds could even win a game. World Series game number one, Tuesday, October 16th, Riverfront Stadium. The Reds' first fall classic engagement in 14 years, dating back to 1976, and a surgical four-game sweep that year of the New York Yankees.
Ladies and gentlemen, a long baseball season and only one item remains. That is, who will be the champion? We certainly hope you enjoy the World Series here on CBS. We visit with both managers before each game. And Tony La Russa said, no changes. If we get Ricky Henderson on base, we're not going to be bunting. We're going to play it the same way we played it all year. Lou Piniella said, we are going to run. We're going to move. We're going to bunt. We're going to steal. We're going to hit and run. And he said, oh, yes, there is one problem, Tim McCarver, trying to get men on base against Dave Stewart.
I think if I were Lou Piniella, the Cincinnati theme tonight should be first things first. Who's up first? Ricky Henderson. And obviously the rest of the lineup contributes mightily for the Oakland A's, but everybody rallies around Ricky. And who's the first pitcher the Reds are going to face? Dave Stewart. I'll tell you, the feeling around baseball now is Dave Stewart is almost invulnerable. As Pat O'Brien said, he's won six straight postseason games, and he is a tough, tough dude, I'm telling you.
Yeah, they've got to beat him somewhere along the line. He could pitch three games, and we have wonderful weather. We'll have a good game. SRO and standing room only for this game with the Cincinnati Reds and the Oakland A's. We'll play the first two games here, then a day off for travel. Friday will be in the Oakland Coliseum. Jose Rio, 25 years old, won one game and two starts against Pittsburgh in the National League playoff. And the batting order to be faced by Rio, it's Ricky Henderson in left, Willie McGee in center field, Jose Canseco in right field, Mark McGuire at first base, Arne Lansford at third, Harry Steinbach behind the plate, Willie Randolph at second, and Mike Gallego at shortstop, and Dave Stewart on the mound. And the crowd gets revved up for the first pitch. Ricky Henderson, you know how he is capable of starting the game with a bang. Try call by Frank Fuller, the plate umpire. We're underway as the flash bulbs pop. It'll be Henderson, McGee, and Canseco here in the Oakland first. Breaking ball, strike two. Keep them on base, at Tim McCarver.
Jose Rio obtained by the Cincinnati Reds from the Oakland Athletics back in December of 1987 in the Dave Parker trade.
On 0-2. High fastball, he fouled it back, 1-2. Ricky. He gets on base, things happen. They explode.
Yeah, I think it's important that Rio got ahead of Henderson. That small strike zone, crouching, trying to duck under everything.
Count 1-2 to the leadoff man. Another foul back here. Hey, he's shooting at us. He shot one to our left, and he sent one straight back here. And the count stays 1-2.
I guess you could say right out of the chute, right?
We don't want any souvenirs, Ricky. Hit it someplace else.
First six pitches and two of them just misses.
Like mortar rounds. One to our left, one to our right. Watch out for this one.
You're out. That's the way this one starts.
And strike three call on the outside corner against Henderson Wood.
I tell you about Frank Foley, this plate umpire. If you're in this game, you better go up there swinging. There's one out.
First thing first, and Ricky Henderson thought this pitch was outside. Look where Oliver is sitting, off the plate away, and that was a liberal strike on Ricky Henderson. Usually if you hit your catcher's mitt that many times in a row, whether it's outside or not, you'll get the pitch.
McGee, ball one. Willie is known to swing at high pitches occasionally, but not that high, ball one. This fella is tough to figure with a bat in his hand. He'll look left and hit it right, vice versa. He'll chase him in the dirt, hit him over, swing over his head. He'll miss a pitch down the middle, and then he'll burn it. He hit 335 and won the National League batting title.
Ricky Henderson still complaining. A little activity and animation after the first batter, thinking that ball was outside.
He is disturbed and perturbed. And it's 1-1 to McGee, switch hitter. Late swing, 1-2.
Yeah, it's so unusual. You say Willie McGee, the National League batting champion, batting 335. He was traded with more than 502 plate appearances. And for that reason, he ended up on top of the National League hitters. Very unusual. He had 113 bats for Oakland in September.
Bouncer to short. Larkin waits, flips, and two out. There don't seem to be any nerves on display here at this moment.
Tim? No, they're really, both teams very impressed with how calm they were during batting practice before the game. Now, this is something that's got to keep you from being calm right there. Here you are hitting balls into the screen with all the media on the field.
And during batting practice, Canseco was pounding the ball.
He was cranking.
He hit one into the upper deck here, and he must have lost about a dozen baseballs. Bad back, bad finger on his right hand. Ball one to him, two out.
Tell you, he gets as much of a reaction out of the crowd as any player in the game today.
Ball one strike, and the Cincinnati fans are cheering on every strike. The first two have been retired. Well, if Rio is going to pitch this well, we know Stewart's going to pitch well. So that's the sort of game we have in store. Rio bringing it, too. That was his best fastball thus far. Well out of the strike zone, 2-1.
That's the scouting report on Canseco. You can tease him away with the slider and off-speed stuff, but you hammer hard inside. That's where pitchers try to pitch him, especially right-handed pitchers. Fastballs inside.
Tim and I both think we're going to see some very aggressive pitching on the part of Cincinnati, knocking these hitters off the plate. They're all right-handed hitters except to be the switch hitter. They're turning on them 2-2.
See, that's a fun thing. I mean, even Canseco, he swings through a pitch and everybody cheers. I mean, he gets a reaction, this guy. He does not go to the plate and get cheated, does he?
National League president, Bill White, is on hand here enjoying the action. He's rooting for the Reds. He's sitting on the Cincinnati side.
Line, the pitch, and it's strike three call. Jose Rijo knocks him off.
Strike out of Canseco. 3-2. Right. Two strikeouts in the inning for Rijo. Another borderline pitch. He fanned Henderson on a called strike and got Canseco on a called strike. One half inning. No score.
Fastball up there in the mid-90s. In fact, a couple of them 97 miles an hour, and you saw those up and in pitches to Canseco that Timmy was talking about. Let's go back upstairs to Jack and Timmy.
Jose had a good first inning. He set them down in order and fanned two along the way. Well, the Oakland pitcher can do the same thing. That's Dave Stewart out there on the mound. He was 2-0 against Boston in the American League Championship Series, and he can bring it also. Here's the starting lineup for Cincinnati. Barry Larkin, Billy Hatcher, Paul O'Neill, Eric Davis, Al Morris, Chris Sabo, Joe Oliver, Mariano Duncan, and Rijo. They'll use the DH when we go to Oakland on Friday. First batter is Larkin. And ball under him. Barry had a half dozen hits against the Pittsburgh Pirates. Had a little dampness around here in this area in recent days. Perfect today. Some of the turf spots still wet. Larkin hits it to deep center field. And Willie McGhee is on the move. He can chase him down, and he took care of that one. One out. Ooh, says the crowd. Hatcher is up, and Philly takes a strike, and Stewart gets ahead. Hatcher, 5 out of 15 with a home run against Pittsburgh. Miss low. One on, one out for Paul O'Neill. One thing about this series, with his open pitching, Stewart, Welch, and Moore, these left-handers such as O'Neill are going to have to do some hitting if Cincinnati is to win. Ball one. Now remember what Lou Pinella told us. He said he's going to run. He's got one of his best base hitters. On in first, and O'Neill at the plate. He's looking at the signs also.
Open it up full throttle. That's what Lou Pinella says. 7 of the 8 guys can run, and I wouldn't be a bit surprised to see Hatcher take off right here.
And a half swing and a strike, 1-1 to O'Neill. Marussa told us he's most concerned with the pitcher getting the ball to the plate in a hurry. So he called a step off.
Right.
Catcher picks up those signs. Now he calls a throw over.
And Hatcher has to dive back. So if he was running, he's less apt to now because of the throws to first base.
Strike call. This plate umpire will keep firing up that right hand. It's Frank Pulley, one ball, two strikes. Stewart trying all the tricks to try to keep Hatcher close. Still at first with two out.
When you throw over there a couple of times, make him dive back, then you bury the delivery, speed up the delivery, then he is less apt to run. You see Paul O'Neill going after that fork ball, that split finger. Both pitchers had that pitch. Dave Duncan taught Dave Stewart, and Jose De Leon taught it.
Would you care to step outside?
Well, they learned it from different people, but very effective with that split finger fastball.
You saw that picture for Eric Davis against Pittsburgh, only four hits. 23 at bats. Hunter going. Fly ball to deep center field. McGee back. It's going to go.
Scored early, and Eric Davis made a very powerful statement.
Watch David. He hits it, and now he looks down for a place to put his bat. He doesn't throw his bat because he knows he's going to trot around the bases and not run around them.
Mark McGwire is up. First pitch of ball from Jose Rijo. Ball two. Rijo got ahead of the hitters in the first inning and fanned two along the way. These Oakland A's have won 10 postseason games in a row. Breaking ball on 2-0. Eric was cheered by the left field fans when he took his position. The Oakland A's in the series against the Giants last year were never behind in any of the four games. 3-1. He can afford to challenge him, leading 2-0. And he did, and he got it off the end of the bat, and it carries out to Hatcher. One out.
Oakland, if they win two more, they tie that those great Yankee teams.
There's a foul going out of play by Carney Lansford. Strike one to him. In those 10 games that they've won in a row, Oakland has never trailed by two runs.
That's remarkable.
That's how good they are. There's one out, a foul off the end of the bat, and that's strike two. And I'll bet this plate umpire has made a few hitters nervous already. He's punched out three uncalled third strikes.
As long as they're consistent, and Frank fully is, Paul O'Neill playing a very shallow right field with two strikes on Carney Lansford.
And a half swing, and Rijo should have time. Save, said the umpire. Ooh, say the fan. First base umpire, Rocky Rowe, the American League umpire, and an infield hit for Lansford with one out. Well, what do you think before we see the replay? Was he safe or out?
I think that ball may have hit the plate, and it appeared that Lansford had it beaten. Good call by Rocky Rowe.
One on, one out, and a foul off the bat of Terry Steinbach. Being in this park brings back fond memories for this batter.
In 1988, he was the most valuable player in the All-Star game. The American League won that game, and Terry had a two-run homer off Doc Gooden in that game, the MVP. Here's that ball off the plate. We said that that's why it had the height that it did, and because it hit the plate and not the dirt, Lansford has a hit, not an out.
Fly ball into short right, and O'Neill is there. They play the right fielder shallow on this Cincinnati club. That's the second out.
See, Lou Piniella was an outfielder, and outfielders know how to play and convey the information about how to play the outfielders better than anybody else. Lou, a right fielder, and you can see him right there moving the outfielders around.
And who did he tell us made him a fine outfielder?
Bill Verdon, ex-manager of the Yankees back in the middle 70s. He said he was the best instructor that he has ever had, and Bill Verdon was in uniform when the Reds beat the Pirates last week, last Friday.
He was wearing the Pirate uniform. The batter is Willie Randolph, getting a chance to start. Al Morris saved that low throw. With Walt Weiss out, Gallego plays short, Randolph plays second base. Willie was 3-for-8 against Boston. Hits it hard into the corner. Davis cuts it off and has a chance at third base. He is safe. He didn't get him. He didn't get him. They want to argue, and it's first and third, two out. Stable not too vehement in his argument. Apparently he missed him.
Well, a lot of times when you're worried about catching the ball, you don't know where the runner is. And I think Lansford made an excellent play by going inside the line to avoid the tag. Not too many guys run on these outfielders. The Reds outfielders led in assists, led the majors. And with Sabo, had he caught the ball and made the slap tag immediately, he probably would have got Lansford. But look at the dive inside the line to be safe at third. An outstanding base running play by Carney Lansford.
You're right. Ends up first and third, two out, and Sabo apparently missed him.
But I'll tell you one thing. You're not going to run a lot against this Cincinnati outfield. Four assists during the National League Championship Series.
Here's Gallego at the plate, and a foul out of play, strike one.
You've heard of change direction in football? You know, when the line goes one way, the quarterback hands it to the back and he goes off the offside? That's a misdirection by Kearney Lansford. Nice base running play by Kearney.
If the A's are to continue the inning, Gallego will have to do something. He was 4-for-10 against the Red Sox. And Leo pumps a strike in there for strike two. This batter takes a little ribbing about his size. He is 5'8", but he is a very effective player. And with Weiss out, he'll be playing shortstop, two up. Leo has two strikeouts. They pitch out, nothing happening. Two out, two balls, two strikes, and the third strikeout for Rio. No runs, two hits, two left, an inning and a half, 2-0, Cincinnati. And by the way, between innings, when the commercials are on, you folks in the Persian Gulf will be receiving video postcards from the folks back home. 1-1 to Sable. Had a home run against Pittsburgh. Spins away from Baltimore. A walk and a home run. Missed the outside part and a leadoff walk and the second pass by Stewart. Let's listen to Joe Oliver, the Cincinnati catcher, talking about Oakland.
Well, they got a great confidence. I guess you could almost call it arrogance. To me, that's tough to compete with. They feel like they can do it at any time, any given situation. And when you get a team that knows that they can beat anybody at any time, it gets you motivated.
Runner going, and a hit and run foul ball out of play. So Lou Piniella, true to his word, he started the runner Sabo, who did steal 25 bases during the season.
I'll tell you, you know, you see this Oakland ball club, and it's easy to think that they're arrogant and cocky. I mean, all of them are big. They look like football players. And they backed up everything. They're world champions. You know, they beat Boston 4 in a row in 1988. And then because of a red-hot pitcher, Oral Hershiser, ran into a buzzsaw in the World Series that year. I tell you, they're good. They know it. And they can back it up.
And they're proud of what they've done.
Absolutely.
Oliver pumps it up, and that will be the first out of the inning. Foul ball, sent by. Runner goes. Oh! And Sable doesn't argue. A terrific throw by Steinbeck. Steinbeck and a quick tag, which made the difference. The one thing that does, losing Sable on the bases, if they get Duncan here, that has the pitcher leading off in the next inning. Cincinnati has only one hit. That was a two-run homer by Eric Davis. Ball four, the third walk by Stewart. That allows the pitcher to bat in the center. Tony Perez talking with the runner. He's the first base coach. Ball one to the pitcher, Rijo, who is 0-for-5 against the Pirates in the playoff and had 10 hits during the regular season. It's a hard to short. Gallego force out. The inning's over. And that's the first man Cincinnati has left. We play two. The Reds lead it 2-0. He's talking with one of the Oakland A's about Dave Stewart's hitting. He said, no chance. Ball one, unless he walks.
Tony La Russa said Mike Moore is the best of the hitting pitchers. Dave Stewart told Jim Cott recently on an interview that there was not a tree big enough to make a bat that could get him to put the bat on the ball.
There's a strike from Rijo, 1-1.
But you know, here's a guy who signed with the Dodgers as a catcher back in 1975. But I guess that's why he became a pitcher, because he couldn't hit.
Chased him out to the mound. At least he's swinging 1-2. When you talk to Dave about his hitting, he'll smile. He doesn't smile on game night, though. gets his fourth strikeout. Now, what's Pat O'Brien thinking about at this moment, Pat?
You know, Jack, it's a school night here in Cincinnati, and as it is elsewhere across the country, but when Mom and Dad have World Series tickets, you get to stay up late. And they probably don't even know this word, but tomorrow, they'll be the envy of the class. They were at the World Series.
Don't
take home a souvenir. Nope. We almost did. Yeah. Back to you.
And that lady's tired, too. She's yawning. Now everybody in Cincinnati is focused on this World Series. Here is Henderson, called out on strikes, much to his dislike, to start the game. He'll probably be swinging early, not to give the umpire another crack at him. Ball one.
Hey, Rick, he's got that real small strike zone. He gets a lot of pitches from the umpires because he does have that small strike zone. See what a pitcher has to pitch to? Out of that crouch. Here it is right here. Supposed to be from the letters to the knees by the time he gets in that crouch. Boy, he squeezes that thing up a lot.
There's a half swing and a foul, putting Ricky in the hole, one and two. Yeah, he makes you come to him, doesn't he?
Like pitching to an accordion.
And there's an A's fan.
If Oliver goes back outside again, slider away.
Too far away. Two and two. A little bit up. Three and two. What's coming on three and two?
Fastball away.
Fly ball into left, and Eric Davis dies. The ball. Henderson goes for second handily with one out. He had it, but the turf made him cough it up.
And I think that left shoulder of his may have had something to do with that. A healthy Eric Davis makes this play. You could see him grimacing in pain. Well, that left shoulder all taped up. He hurt it a couple of weeks ago when he ran into the wall. And I don't know if he ever had that ball cleanly, but he really hurts that shoulder when he dives on the turf, landing right on that shoulder. See, it hit the heel of the glove. It comes out. He never really had possession. But more importantly for the Reds, he could have re-injured that shoulder.
That's the third hit for Oakland. And Henderson, the runner at second, is terrific at stealing third. The batter is Willie McGee. And he hits it to second for Duncan. Runner to third, two out. Pinella will watch this Rio Canseco battle, and Mark McGuire is on deck. Jose has hit only three home runs in the last 49 games since the 3rd of August. He was swinging on Pinella, chased a bad ball.
He was swinging at anything then. That was a slider away out of the strike zone. Canseco says, no walk for me.
That's a big boy. You're not going to walk me.
Uh-huh.
3-1. He did walk him, and that's the first given by Rijo. Tying runs are on base. At first and third, and Pinella wants to talk. Wire fly to center his first time, and a foul on a breaking ball.
If he gets another quick strike, you can look for Canseco to be running 0-2, 1-2.
And one for Larkin. And he's over. Four left for Oakland early. We'll return to Riverfront Stadium after this word from your local station. Ball two. Larkin from a wonderfully athletic family. He attended the University of Michigan.
As did Hal Morris and Chris Sabo.
baseball three. This is not the Dave Stewart that we know. Look where those kids are. And the first base foul line. Couple of A's fans.
Three would-be catchers. They got their caps turned around.
Look at this from Dave Stewart. His fourth walk, and he puts a good base dealer on. And four straight bad pitches. He is not himself. You know, one of the things could be the pitching mound.
Maybe.
I'm sure it's not the pressure of the situation bothering him, but sometimes even the best don't perform at their best.
It could be the fact that this is his sixth day, too. The Athletics clinching last week against Boston. They had to wait for the series to start, of course, so this is his sixth day. He may be stronger, but his control has been off.
You're right about that. And the runner not going, and a bunt foul by Hatching. Runner not going. And that ball is fair. And the run will score. 3-0 Cincinnati. The runner goes to third. He's safe there. Nobody out.
Stewart sets and delivers, and Hatcher swing pulls it. Fair down the left field line.
Dave Stewart is not used
not used to this sort of transpirings. He doesn't like it, you can tell.
Six postseason wins in a row.
Morris hits it to McGuire. To the pitcher, and the inning is over. Two runs, one hit, one error. After three, 4-0 Cincinnati. Batter is Steinbach. And the Oakland catcher takes ball one. He flied to right his first time. Perry rang up five hits against the Red Sox in postseason. It's a foul out of play, 1-1. And the Cincinnati pitcher, Jose Rio, is getting along very, very well. The A's about hit Cincinnati 3-2, but the Reds lead 4-0. Well, Oakland is going to get Todd Burns ready. Fly ball foul out of play, 2-2, because their pitcher is due to bat fifth in this inning. So Tony La Russa has to deal with pinch hitters and so forth, and no DH tonight. Swinging a bad ball, even the count 2-2.
You saw Lou Piniella there. Is always aware of the depth of the opposite fielder. And with two strikes on the hitter, a hitter becomes more of a defensive hitter, not an offensive hitter. So that means he's not going to be able to hit the ball, generally speaking, that far the other way.
Breaking ball, got Steinbach. That's a fifth strikeout by the Oakland A's, and he has Perry talking to himself.
Yeah, see, you would never see a swing like this from a hitter with the count 2-0 and 1-0. That was a defensive swing. Terry was just trying to make contact, and that again is why you move that opposite fielder in.
Oakland is stranded four. The first two have been retired here. Willie Randolph is up. And a strike to him, and a quick look back at the umpire. And Dave Stewart wondering how long he's going to stay in this game. The A's get a rally going, and they'll lift him right here in this inning, but there are two up. Broken bat. Oh, look at that. Behind the knee. Hey, that's pretty cute, isn't it? I'll see that again. That's all for Oakland in the top of the fourth inning. Cincinnati will come to bat with Sabo to lead it off. Watch this cutie pie play here.
Rio Rojo Caliente.
Looking at what has transpired, Eric Davis hit a two-out, two-run home run in the first inning for a 2-0 lead, and then in the third, a walk, a double, an error, and an infield out, as Cincinnati on top here, 4-0 in the bottom of the fourth. Dave Stewart has walked four, allowed two hits and pitches to Chris Sabo, and a foul back here. That's about four of them have come whistling back up here. There's Eric Davis having a little problem with that right hand after diving into the turf. And Stewart blew that one right by Sabo. When you watch Stewart pitch, Tim, you see a lot of batters swing right through it. You wonder how in the world they didn't hit the ball.
Now, he challenges you. I don't think there's any pitcher in either league that pitches right-handers inside as much as Stewart.
One ball, two strikes. Leadoff man has been on base in two out of three innings for Cincinnati. But not this inning, as Sabo goes down on strikes. The big blow in this game. After a walk to Hatcher in the first, this two-out swing by this man, Eric Davis. And as Tim McCarver said, tell when he looked down, he knew it was gone. The batter is out of breaking ball. Ball one to Joe. He fouled out his first time. Well, Eric, you're out of your slump. Pop this one up for the second out. Who's going to get it? Third baseman Lansford. there, two out. And the pitcher, Dave Stewart, will now try for his first 1-2-3 inning of the game.
We talked about his six consecutive victories. If he were to come back, if his team were to come back tonight and win this game, he would tie Bob Gibson. Bob Gibson had seven consecutive victories in the 64, 67, and 68 World Series. Lefty Gomez, you see, was six. Red Ruffing was six. Pretty good company.
And a strike on the inside part to Duncan. He walked his first time. That really hurt Stewart because it allowed the pitcher to bat in that inning. That's through the hole with two out, and the pitcher will bat in this inning.
Hey, the Reds were so productive in their number two and their number eight holes this year. From the eighth hitting spot, they had 16 home runs and 84 RBIs. And their number two hitter batted 307. That is unusual production out of a lineup from the number two and eight hole, but it shows you how balanced the Cincinnati lineup is.
And pretty well balanced left side, right side.
Uh-huh.
Here is Riho in into a force out his first time. He'll swing. He might even bunt, but they're aware of that because Lansford is looking right down his throat. Ball one to Jose. Jose is looking at the third base coach and saying, what are you looking at me for? Runner at first, two out. One and one.
Yeah, sometimes it's just not, I think hitters look down at the third base coach out of habit. Here it is, one and one. There's no sense in looking down there. You're hitting. Two outs.
One and one, and Stewart steps off. Ron Schuler is one who has done some scouting for this Oakland team. And a bounce to third, and that's where Lansford was playing in, guarding against the bunt, and the inning is over. Now the Reds have left two, but after four, they lead 4-0. This game we go, the hits even, three apiece, the Reds leading 4-0. And this overhead view of Riverfront and the crowd standing room only. There's Norm Charlton. He's likely first out of the bullpen tonight for the Reds. And all Cincinnati wants from Jose Riho is a couple of more innings. Gallego, the number eight hitter, leads it off. And his first time. All one. Back with a strike. Gallego, the number eight hitter in the lineup. And Riho throws low. And we have Doug Jennings waiting on deck, and he will bat for Dave Stewart. And then we're going to have this new pitcher, and that is Todd Burns. Out of play, 2-2. So Stewart will be through after pitching four innings. Gave four runs, three hits. He walked four. I'm sure that bothers him more than anything. And he had three strikeouts.
Yeah, two of those walks scored. One in front of the Eric Davis homer, and one in front of the double by Hatcher.
Fly ball for O'Neill. And one out. Only, well, the Oakland club has yet to put their leadoff man on base. O'Neill's start in the playoff against Pittsburgh. Some thought he'd be the MVP, but he wasn't. This Ohio River is busy beyond the stadium. The river boats flying up and down. Restaurants that are moored there. There's a strike going to be played off by Frank Foley, 1-1. Jennings in the hole. didn't get it. We're in the fifth, 4-0 Cincinnati. Jennings gets the base hit in a right. That's the fourth hit for the visiting Oakland club. Well, the pinch hitter came through at the right time for Oakland, and Ricky took ball up. Blistering fastball for Wheeler. Now, well, depending on what Henderson does, Willie McGee may turn out to be a key man in the spring. Got a call tonight. Ricky had 28 home runs during the season. One on, one out. Maybe a double play ball, but Henderson can run, and he is safe at first. There was little chance to get him in the first place, and Ricky is on a fearless choice. Two out in the inning.
You know, the one thing about Ricky Henderson, he is an outstanding base runner, but from home to first, his big swing inhibits him from going full speed to first base. He goes as fast as he can, but it takes him time to get kind of uncoiled to get going back toward first base. That long swing, that's why he has so much power, 28 home runs this year. He doesn't run from home to first nearly as fast as from first to second to third.
Well, we know he can run, and McGee hits a foul, strike one. Willie is grounded to short, grounded to second.
936 career stolen bases, two behind Lou Brock to break the all-time record.
Why did he do it this year?
I thought he'd let things settle over the winter. I mean, here's a guy 31 years old. He could end up with 1,500 stolen bases. Conceivably.
He's not taking a very big lead at all. There goes Henderson. And a base hit by McGee. Ricky goes on to third. Well, here we go with Rio against Canseco. First and third, two out. Enjoy this scene. Swing and a throw and a save by the first baseman Al Morris. And he gets McGee. Canseco has struck out and walked. Strike, 2-2.
Four-run lead and a 2-1 slider that freezes Canseco.
Throw a stolen base for McGee. Now it's 3-2 to Canseco. And a base hit would mean a couple. Home run will make it a one-run game. They have a base open. McGuire next. And Pinella chomps on the chewing gum. Side, he walked in. That is the second walk by Rio, both given to Canseco. And the bases are loaded two out as a tying run comes to the plate. And the batter will be Mark McGuire. He could tie it up in a blink. Ricky Henderson at third. Willie McGee on at first. Three pass runners, including Canseco at first. Him up. Second baseman wants it. And now Oakland has left seven. And after 4.5, they still trail 4-0. And the hometown crowd is enjoying this a good deal more than the Oakland fans. The Reds lead 4-0, though they've been out hit 5-3. Not only that, Cincinnati has chased Dave Stewart from the game, and Todd Burns takes over. 3-3 with three saves during the season. This is the first postseason appearance this year for Todd Burns. And he'll face the top of the order, Barry Larkin. In the dirt. Larkin has flied out, walked and scored. Gentlemen, watching TV, how are you, sir? Nice to chat with you.
He's looking at himself on television, look at that.
Give us some
reaction, huh?
Give him a microphone, we can talk. Here's one of pop fly for the second baseman, Willie Randolph, one out.
I'll tell you, in 2 years ago, a limping wonder walked to home plate at Dodger Stadium, and everybody remembers.
Remembers Lee. Gibson swings and a fly ball to deep right field.
This is going to be a home run. Unbelievable. A home run for Gibson. And the Dodgers have won the game 5-4. I don't believe what I just saw.
And it's Billy Hatcher, ball one.
And I still don't believe what we just saw after that great call of yours two years ago.
I was so shocked. I was thinking about Gibson. Here's another hit for Hatcher. He doubled previously. This is his third time on base, and it's another double. This one with one out. Billy Hatcher starring tonight.
This looks like a replay of Hatcher's last hit. Almost in the identical spot. Look at Carney Lansford playing in. And Hatcher with an easy double. He had 28 during the year. And Lou Piniella thinks that third base is the easiest base to steal. So what Todd Burns has to do is keep an eye on Hatcher.
With one out. And O'Neill at the plate. O'Neill 0-for-2 with an RBI. And Todd Burns and his catcher are going to talk it over. Tim going back to that Gibson home run. High run at second, two out, bad knee and all. I thought against Eckersley, he just hit it up the middle or drove the other way, and the home run was the furthest thing from my mind in 88.
The only at bat in the series, the Dodgers went on to win in 5. Unbelievable.
That's what the Reds are trying to do here, shock Oakland tonight. Pitch goes low.
Tonight it was Eric Davis who shocked the Athletics early.
Strike call. Looked like Hatcher, to me, was trying to measure a running start from second base.
Yeah, we talked about Cincinnati stealing third. They attempted to steal third more than any other team in the major leagues, 46 times this year.
Two balls and a strike to Paul O'Neill.
Give you some idea of how many times that is. The Oakland Athletics only tried to steal third 34 times, and that's with Ricky Henderson stealing 65 bases.
Shortstop Gallego trying to keep Hatcher close. Outside to the batter, 3-1, only one out. That's Hatcher. He has walked, scored, double driven and a run and scored, and doubled again. What a night he's having. Fifth walk given to the Reds, who go with their four hits. Who's up? Who's up? The two on, one out. Eric Davis. Could make a shambles of this game. Caruso knows that. Davis up there. The infield plays him to pull. The outfield straight away. Shortstop can't keep Hatcher close. And the left field. They bring Hatcher home. And he is safe, and it's 5-0.
Todd Burns trying to come in on Davis with that sinking fastball. But again, when you fall behind in the count and you have to come into the strike zone to major league hitters, you are asking
for trouble. The throw by Henderson, not nearly strong enough, and Hatcher scores easily.
An early visit to the mound by La Russa.
See, Hatcher take off immediately. He didn't have to wait. The ball was hit high enough to where there was no danger of Gallego making the play, and Hatcher taking off immediately and scores easily. Third RBI for Eric Davis.
But these Reds, five runs on five hits with the help of five walks plus an error.
Little help for my friends.
Gene Nelson cranks it up. Now this is what happens when you get rid of a starter like Stewart. Davis, Ian Hatcher have been burning things up tonight.
Even though I'll tell you that Oakland Athletic middle relief corps, really underrated and unheralded. They are outstanding.
Al Morris, right to him. Russo went out and told Burns what he wanted. There's Billy Hatcher, a walk, two doubles, three runs scored, and an RBI. First and second one out. This batter really strides into the ball. You see his right foot? It ends up very close to the plate when he swings. Breaking ball, he fouled. One and two, and Morris sprays the ball around the park.
Morris almost has the ability to hit with his feet mobile. He really steps into the ball literally. He moves his back foot and his front foot. There's not just the one stride into the ball. Look at the unusual way that Al Morris moves his feet when he approaches the hitting position.
Inside to even a 2-2. Doing a little tap dance in the batter's box. I bet Todd Burns didn't expect to be in this game in the fifth inning. Dave Stewart starting. Two on, one out. Three and two. And leading 5-0, they'll probably start the runner.
Absolutely.
Second, Davis at first. They're on the move. And it avoids the double play. And it's second and third, two out. It would have been a double play had the runners not been going, two out.
You take more chances when you're ahead. This ball is scorched to second base. Runners running. You can see O'Neill and Davis. And the only play Willie Randolph has is the first base to easily get Morris. But no question, that's a double play had they not been running.
They're going to pitch to Sabo, but he'll probably have to fish for something to hit. With first base open, ball one, and Joe Oliver, another right-handed batter, but a lesser hitter coming up next. Sabo has walked and fainted. Up the middle. He can throw. Two more runs. It's 7-0.
Watch how Sabo goes down and gets the slider. That's how Pittsburgh got him out. Pinella has helped him.
There's a base hit by Oliver. There goes the runner to third. He is safe at third with two outs.
Gonna say Lou Pinella has helped Chris Sabo stay back on the wall. Joe Oliver going to right field. I think you can clearly see that something was wrong with Jose Canseco's throwing hand when he threw that ball to third base. Jose normally with an outstanding arm. He almost pushed that ball to third base. Watch this throw by Canseco. Normally a much stronger arm and a much closer play. Not even close.
Here comes Tony La Russa. And here comes a new man from the bullpen. It's Gene Nelson. The Reds have made 7 runs on 7 hits and lead 7-0. They've done in postseason, inning in 2/3 during the regular season, 3-3 with 5 saves. First and third, 2 out, 3 runs home in the 5th. Reds leading 7-0. And the batter is Mariano Duncan, ball 1. Over at the base, it is Chris Sabo. And at first base, Joe Oliver. At the plate, Duncan. He has walked and singled. I was surprised earlier they let Sabo hit the ball with first base open, even though Oliver did come through with a base hit.
Well, I mean, you know, that when you're trailing by 5 runs, there's not a lot you can do. Oliver did get the hit, but what they wanted Sabo to do was to hit a tough pitch, and he hit a tough pitch. I mean, he really went down and got that ball. Sometimes you just got to tip your hat to the hitter.
7 runs, 7 hits, fly ball to deep left by Duncan. Henderson back at the track, and that ends the inning. It is 3 more runs for Cincinnati. On 3 hits, they lead 2. They've left 4. We'll return to Riverfront Stadium after this word from your local station. Ernie Lansford starts it with a base hit here in the 6th inning, his 2nd hit of the night. And don't count this Oakland club out. They won 103 games this year. And they know how to handle adversity as well as victories. There's the bench, and tomorrow night at 8 o'clock Eastern Time here on CBS, Game 2 of the World Series. And the starters, Bob Welch, the 27-game winner for Oakland, against Danny Jackson, 6-6 for the Reds. Tomorrow night on CBS, the runner going. What do you think of this? A stolen base for Lansford. I guess Garney knows the score is 7-0.
Well, no surprise when Ricky Henderson takes off with a score 4-0. But a big surprise when Garney Lansford takes off with a score 7-0. First pitch, hook slide. It looked like he slid into the glove of Barry Larkin. Watch this. Watch his left foot. Nope, he got it out of the way.
Sure did.
Good
he's
call.
Safely at second, nobody out, and a foul ball by Steinbeck, and they're going up there swinging.
Tell you, that hook slide, though, you just don't get to the base as quickly as a straight-in slide. That's really a slide that is not in vogue nearly as much now as it was 25 years ago.
0 for 2 is Steinbeck. And the count 1-1 on him. And this gentleman harkens back to 61.
Yankees beat the Reds in the World Series in 5 games.
Here should be the first out of the inning. Duncan throws to get the Oakland catcher. 1 out. And the runner to third. Steinbeck is 0 for 3. Willie Randolph is 1 for 2. Seven to nothing, Cincinnati, 6th inning. A chopper foul. Of course, with the lead such as it is, the Reds are playing deep and willing to give up a run for an out. Single by Lansford leading off in the 6th, stolen base. The 3rd on the infield out, and one strike two.
I look around the stadium, and I don't think I've ever seen as many banners at Riverfront Stadium as I'm seeing here tonight. This is not necessarily a banner stadium. Banner town, they're having a banner year,
yes,
granted,
they are.
But you don't see a lot of banners here in this ballpark. And you certainly don't see that guy this time of year, do you?
We've been here for a long time, haven't we?
This guy took a left when he should have taken a right.
1-2 to Randolph. fly into short right for O'Neill. The runner tags but doesn't come. Two out.
Yeah, you just can't take chances like that when you're trailing by seven runs, especially with Paul O'Neill in right field. We mentioned earlier, 47 assists for the Cincinnati outfielders, the most in the major leagues this year, and they added four more in the championship series, and there it is right there. You don't run on these guys. Also, the fewest errors, only 10. So they know how to play the outfield.
Runner at third, two out. Fly ball for O'Neill to chase, and he has it, and Oakland still hasn't scored. Now the A's have stranded eight while being shut out. Bottom of the sixth, 7-0 Cincy. Jose Reno gets a big hand as he walks to the plate. He's 0-2, but he is shut out open. Six hits in six innings. Gene Nelson, base hit. Hey, Jim Cott, what do you think about Reho staying in the game and the bullpen not being employed at this stage?
Well, man, I'm all for it, Jack. I mean, the guy's got a shutout going and gets a base hit. I think sometimes you can reach a little far maybe if you take a pitcher out of a game who's got it going like Reho. He looks just fine from here. Save the nasty boys till later.
Pitchers stick together, Tim.
Well, I don't know, Kitty. I'm going to have to disagree. I know this isn't any point counterpoint or anything like that, but if you're going to start, if this series goes to seven games, Rio's going to have to start twice on 3 days rest. He's only done it twice this year. He did it once in the LCS.
Well, we'll see what comes of it. Rio not only stayed in the game and hit, but got a hit. Strike one to Barry Larkin, who is 0-2 with a walk. Name it on Reho. Earlier, Tim said Reho is Rojo, red caliente, red hot, and he is. He's having a big night here, as are Hatcher and Davis. Two balls in the strike.
I know Kitty's point. If Reho has only thrown, say, 90 pitches, 95 pitches with a shutout going, what's the difference in 95 and 130? If you could somehow gauge that and say that if he throws 130, he'd be less effective 3 days from now, then I think Lou would take him out, but not now.
Rio is out, and so's the batter on a dandy play by Willie Randolph. What a good play by Randolph. Larkin is retired on the 4-3 double play here in the sixth.
Boy, that's a terrific play by a seasoned veteran right there. 42 postseason games. This is his 43rd. Only Davey Lopes and Joe Morgan have played more games at second base in the postseason, and he's never made an error.
And he wouldn't let Reho tangle with him. He let him go by, tagged him, and cleared the runner and got the batter. Wonderful play.
You talk about a classy act, the ex-Yankee captain Willie Randolph.
Billy Hatcher is up. Well, what else is he going to do? He's walked, doubled, scored three runs, and driven in a run. Gene Nelson, the third pitcher of the night, throws high. Oh, Gene Nelson has been very effective for the club all season. Hatcher fouls it out of play to keep it 1-2. A good play by a bat. They call this the Queen City of Ohio. Look at the downtown area with a new office building in the forefront. It's a nice town. People had a big rally today at noon. 7,000 people downtown. Hatcher stays up there.
Downtown scoring got underway tonight. Eric Davis going downtown on Dave Stewart. He didn't go that far downtown, however.
And that's what started all of this. There's Eric, a two-run, two-out home run in the first. He's also had another hit and run batted in. Hatcher. What a good play by Lansford, but another base hit for Hatcher. He's is on base for the fourth time. He's 3-for-3. Andrew is hustling. O'Neill's the batter. He is 0-for-2 with a walk, a run scored, and a run batted in. And a walk to O'Neill. There have been two hits and a walk in the second. So with Bob Welch and Danny Jackson tomorrow night, there's Bob, a 27-game winner this year. Davis is up. I've been here earlier in the year when they've been booing him, but not tonight. He's 2-for-3 with 3 RBIs. He has 2 on, 2 out. Ball one.
See, I think the boos come from when you sign a new contract. I think people think you should immediately justify the contract you just signed. You make $3 million a year, you should be playing like a $3 million player. He's being paid on what he did, not on what he's doing.
2-0 as Nelson struggles.
That's what happens with players like Davis. They sign big contracts, and most of the time, the reason they don't do it is they're trying too hard, not hard enough. Not trying too hard enough. I guess that was clear.
They got him this time, and Gallegos steps on the base, and the Reds leave 2. They've left 6. We've played 6. Cincinnati leads it 7-0.
Dominican Dandy, and I'm telling you, he was the toughest right-handed pitcher that I faced, Juan Marichal. He is doing the Spanish radio to 50 million people. That is they're being broadcast to over 60 countries, and he is the father-in-law of Jose Rijo. What a proud papa-in-law he must be tonight.
Here is Ron Hassey, a left-handed batter, pinch hitting for Nelson. We'll see Hassey catching Bob Welch tomorrow night. Rijo has a 6-hit shutout going. And it's 7-0 Cincinnati. And ball one to the pinch hitter. There's Rob Dibble in the bullpen waiting to see how Rijo gets along here at the start of the 7th. Hasn't started to throw yet. Good swing by Hassey, 1-1.
Look at this. The Oakland Athletics, when leading after 6 innings, have won 79 of 83. The Cincinnati Reds lead the National League, winning 74 of 80 when leading after 6 innings. So they wrap it up with that bullpen in a hurry.
Yeah, we know why. Hassey leading off, pops it up to O'Neill and Wright. One out in the 7th inning. I guess Lou Piniella is going to go down the line with Rijo as long as he has this shutout going, as Jim Cott suggested earlier.
Well, if that's the case, why is Dibble warming up? Because I would think that with a guy like Dibble who throws so hard, that you're not going to warm him up unless he's going in the ballgame.
Yeah, don't waste him out there.
Yeah, right. Here's a guy who could shake hands with you and throw the next pitch 93 miles an hour.
Ricky Henderson, the batter, ball one. If you were warming up Dibble in the bullpen, would you wear a mask?
I would wear more than that, Jack.
Henderson has 1-for-3, a double. Ricky gets his 2nd hit of the night. Boy, what a good player he is. Whew. And he'll probably be running despite the score. 7-0.
Sure.
He swiped while they were running earlier.
Well, the Athletics will have the Cy Young Award winner, Bob Welch, in all likelihood, the MVP, and Ricky Henderson. He can do so many things. Many feel that he's the best leadoff hitter of all time, and I'm one of those many.
Oh, yeah. I would throw in with you there. Best leadoff hitter of all time.
That's saying something.
There have been a lot of them. So it's one out in the 7th inning. And the batter, Willie McGee. That might be a double play. They got one. Yep. 4-6-3. That's all in the Oakland 7th, and they still trail 7-0. score here is 7-0. Bottom of the seventh inning. There's the line score. Started with the Eric Davis home run in the first inning, and then the Reds two more in the third, and three more in the fifth inning against Todd Burns. The kid's wearing both hats. He'll go either. He's like that kid with the two hats is like a hitchhiker in a bad town. He'll go either way. There is a pitch hit by Hal Morris to start the seventh inning, and he greets Scott Sanderson in rude fashion. With Sable batting here, nobody out in the seventh inning. Rob Dibble starts to crank it up again. In fact, he's been warming up, and he's ready now. First is going again, and a shot into center field for McGee. He gets it, tries to double the runner at first base with a good throwing arm, but the runner is back in time. McGee can throw. One out. Now the fans come alive. They want more than seven. Maybe a double play. Gallego bobbles it. They get one. They get two. And the inning is over. 6-4-3. We played seven innings at Riverfront Stadium. 7-0 Reds. Here comes Dibble. Rob Dibble pitched against Jose Canseco. This should be fun as we go into the eighth inning. 7-0 Cincinnati.
I really should. It doesn't matter what the score. Rob Dibble against Jose Canseco. Two big guys, one who throws hard, one who hits hard. This is fun right here.
They'll both cut it loose. Strike. Dibble's been in four postseason games. Five innings, no hits. Struck out 10. Canseco, 0-for-1 with two walks tonight. 1-1.
Dibble retired 15 of the 16 Pittsburgh Pirates he faced. The only guy who got on was on a walk. He is one of the nasty boys, Rob Dibble.
Fly ball to center field, and Hatcher goes back. One out. Hey, Jim Cott, do you have a line on Rob Dibble?
Yeah, he's still driving in the school zone, Jack. He only had that about 94, 95. He doesn't have it cranked up at highway speed yet, but it's quick enough.
94. I'm glad I'm up here.
What school is that, Kitty?
School of high heat.
There's one out in the eighth, and the batter's McGuire. Here's another big swinger, another big strike. And Lou Piniella was talking with us tonight. He said the amazing thing about Dibble, as hard as he throws, is that he does throw strikes. And there's another one. But that gives it in. And slow. What does the radar show now, James?
Well, he's out of the city, Jack and Tim, in the last couple, 98 and 99.
2-2. Well, if he knew you were clocking him and reporting on him, he'd probably send it up to the century mark. There's Bill White. He could hit the fastball. Two hits and a strong base tonight.
Well, they say heat rises. If there's any heater that rises more than a Rob Dibble fastball, I know house heat does it. I mean, this guy can blow.
There's nothing fancy.
No.
Fastball, slider. Both are about the same speed.
One on, one up. Foul, strike two. Not as on the field level. He's watching Dibble, blocking those pitches. We get reports from him. And it is getting a little cooler here at the park as Cop dons the raincoat. 0-2 to Carney Lansford.
See, that's the reason Pinella brings in Dibble. It's getting a little cold, so he brought him in with the heater, right? I mean, he is throwing hard. Lou knows it, loves it.
And Carney Lansford flies it out to center field to Hatcher for the second out. Two men gone. Hatcher in center having a good night with a glove and with a bat. At the plate is Terry Steinbach. He's 0 for 3. And the second baseman can't get it. Steinbach gets his first hit, and there are two on, two out. Billy Randolph, ball one, and it bent the glove back of Oliver. We'll see how they rule on that. As McGuire gets over to third and Steinbach down to second. Now to Randolph, a strike, and that blistered in there. Shortstop Larkin waits. Rolls, and the shutout is still going. And now Oakland has left 10. And Eckersley pitching to Mariano Duncan. Has a strike on the corner, and he can paint. Eckersley's record, control record, is astounding.
It's scary. It is.
Foul ball by Duncan, who has had a hit and a walk, one for two. This year, he walked four batters, one of them intentional. And last year, he walked three batters.
I guess he's slumping this year.
And he gets a strikeout of Duncan. Now Rob Dibble is through after pitching one inning, giving up a hit and a walk. Todd Benzinger will bat for him. Switch hitter. And in the bullpen, Randy Myers will work the ninth.
He'll work the ninth for the same reason as Jim said, that Dennis Eckersley is working the eighth, just to get to work.
Benzinger hits an R to McGee, and that's the second out of the inning. It's going to be a 1-2-3 inning for Dennis Eckersley as Canseco makes the catch and sends us into the ninth inning with the scoreboard saying 7-0 Cincinnati.
Four at Riverfront, they have the crown jewels of the Cincinnati Reds and historic past here, the world champion trophies from the Big Red Machine, 75 and 76, Pete Rose statue. But if you're a real baseball collector, this is the one I think you want. The 1919 baseball from the world champions back then. It's signed by the winning pitcher, Dutch Ruther. And Tim, that's about the only player you haven't told me a story about.
I don't know who Dutch Ruther was. That was the year of the Black Sox scandal, though.
Here's Gallego on a strike, and now a foul. Strike two with Randy Myers on the hill for Cincinnati in the ninth.
Cincinnati beat the White Sox 5-3, 5-3. That was when the World Series was 5 out of 9, the best 5 out of 9. 1919, 20, and 21, after having an earlier 5 out of 9 in 1903.
And Myers gets a strikeout of Gallego. There's Jose. He'll be the winning pitcher. He worked the first seven in a 7-hit shutout. Benzinger next to him. And the batter is Dave Henderson, pinch hitting for Dennis Eckersley, who had an easy eighth inning. Henderson is one of these happy people. He's always smiling. Oakland has won 10 postseason game in a row. Strike one to Henderson. Leadoff man is gone. And the pitch is low. Tim McIver, the one thing we must establish here, if Cincinnati was going to have a chance to win the series, they had to beat Dave Stewart somewhere along the line. And apparently they've done it here tonight.
It will certainly be a psychological benefit going into tomorrow's game. And regardless of the outcome of tomorrow's game, knowing that they have broken a 10-game winning streak going into Oakland on Friday.
And six postseason victories in a row by Dave Stewart, right, who last year threw a five-hit shutout against the Giants in the opening game. Henderson got a good swing at that one. So a couple of straights are going down the tube tonight. Oakland has left 10 men on base tonight while being shut out. And another strikeout for Randy Myers. So the Reds have asserted themselves here this evening. They're not only going to win this game, they have asserted themselves as good champions of the National League, capable of winning the World Series. Not that they're going to, but they could. Ricky Anderson is the third man up in this inning. And the fans want this game to end right here. They're on their feet. Ricky has had a single and a double, 2-for-4. So he's his old self. And he'll be on display here tomorrow night. And it's Bob Welch against Danny Jackson. See how the left-hander fares against Oakland. Strike. Ricky gets his third hit of the night. And he'll shoot down to second base ahead of the throw from Eric Davis. 3-for-5 for Ricky Henderson. And the ninth Oakland hit. By the way, if they leave him on, they will tie a record of leaving 11 men on while being shut out in the World Series.
Been done four times, most recently by the Orioles versus the New York Mets back in 1969. That's real unusual to leave 11 men stranded and be shut out.
Willie McGhee has a hit, 1-for-4. The only switch hitter in their lineup this evening, ball one. The Reds got two in the first on the home run by Eric Davis. Two in the third, a walk to Larkin, double by Hatcher. Infield out by O'Neill. They got three in the fifth. Double by Hatcher, single by Davis. Two run single by Sabo. Hatcher, three hits and a walk. Davis, single and a home run and three RBIs. A walk and a two-run single by Sabo. Has a 7-0 in the ninth, two out. And McGhee hits it to O'Neill. The Reds have won it. Cincinnati going in the very first inning. A walk to Hatcher and this two-out home run by Eric Davis. And Dave Stewart pitched four innings and gave up four runs. Pat O'Brien is going to come along with much more here on the heels of the opener, with Cincinnati winning it 7-0.
Stadium, where the Reds have just defeated the Athletics 7-0 in Game 1 of the World Series, and he may not be laying claim to Mr. October just yet, but for sure he is Mr. October 16th. And let's go down and talk to Eric Davis, who's Jim Cotton.
He sure is, Pat. I mean, they're rocking here in Cincinnati, and what I got to ask Eric is, now the word we got, you're going to come out tonight, You're just going to try to make contact, hit singles, go the other way. Didn't work out that way.
Well, that's what I was trying to do, Kitty. I was just going out there trying to make good, solid contact. I just got a pitch that I can handle and get my arms extended, and, you know, that just goes to show you that all you got to do is put the bat on the ball.
You know, the one thing that I think everyone was concerned about, if you're a Cincinnati fan, is when you go for that ball, left shoulder, but you tell me it's the little finger on your right hand that you
hit. Well, that's when I did. I jammed my pinky finger. When I dove, I tried to balance myself, and then I jammed a little bit, but it'd be all right.
So you come out, you hear all about Dave Stewart, and he surprised us tonight, not throwing as well as you thought he would?
Well, I didn't think he threw that bad. I think we were patient. We got ahead in the counts, and the kind of pitches that they have, they're going to come right at you. And, you know, we were just trying to be patient, and we hit the ball pretty good.
All right, let's go back to Pat O'Brien.
All right, Jim, thank you very much, and congratulations to Eric Davis. And you could have booked this one. The Chevrolet player of the game is Eric Davis of the Cincinnati Reds. Chevrolet will donate $1,000 in his behalf to the Special Olympics. We'll be back in a minute. Stay with us.